stand and sing. What a beautiful name it is, our call to worship. The lyrics will be on the screen.
What a beautiful name. like to welcome everybody here this morning to Beaver Dam Baptist Church. Isn't it a wonderful and glorious thing to be in the house of the Lord this morning?
Amen.
If you are visiting with us, it is a joy, it is a honor to have you here with us this morning. I would ask that you would please fill out a share card that you'll find in your pew pocket, as we would love to have a record of your visit to know how we can minister better unto you. I'd like to just bring to your attention one thing this morning, as we'll do our announcements a little bit later. But there is a sign-up sheet in the back if you would like to do the flower of the week. If you would like to put the flower here and you'd like to have that in memory of somebody or in honor of somebody, please sign up and you'll have your turn to do that. At this time, I would like to go ahead and ask Joe if he would make his way down here and he would sit here in this seat this morning. On the 16th of January, Joe will go in for a quadruple bypass surgery, very serious surgery that he is going in for. We are going through the book of James on Sunday mornings. I want to read to you from James chapter 5 this morning. Is anyone among you suffering? He should pray. Is anyone cheerful? He should sing praises. Is anyone among you sick? He should call for the elders of the church. They are to pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick person. The Lord will raise him up. If he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. We know that the effective, faithful prayer of the righteous heard of the Lord. And so, while I have no power within myself nor within you to save or to heal, we serve a God that still heals. Amen?
Amen.
We serve a God that cares for the flock, and we serve a God that protects and watches over. And so I want to invite the church to come down this morning. We're going to just gather around this brother, and we're going to pray for this upcoming surgery, very serious surgery. We're going to ask the Lord to be with him in a special way as he goes through that. So if you want to come down, make your way around to this brother, and we're going to have a time of prayer, and I'll close with us in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, as we gather here this morning and as we lift our brother Joe up to you today, Lord, we pray, Father, for your care. We pray for your providence. We pray, God, that your hand would be upon him, Lord. We pray, God, that you would just protect him, Lord. God, as he prepares to go into this very serious surgery, Lord. We pray for the surgeon. We pray for that team. We pray for all in care over him. And God, we just pray, Lord, that you would use them, God. We pray that you would just lay your providence on him as he goes through this surgery, God. And Lord, we just pray for your will to be done in the life of our brother. For it's in Jesus' name we pray this morning. Amen.
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 Our praise hymn this morning is In Christ Alone. Let's all stand and sing together with the lyrics on the screen, In Christ Alone.
Thank you.
As we think of all that's going on here at Beaver Dam Baptist Church, I just want to encourage you to read your bulletin, your roadmap to what's going on here in the life of the church. But I do want to share a couple of things with you. I want to share with you that next Sunday morning, we are baptizing three people to the membership of the church. And so that is praiseworthy. I would also say that if you're sitting in this sanctuary today and you want to respond to baptism, then please get with me as soon as you can this week. Talk with me. I'd love to talk with you about exploring baptism as we prepare this Sunday to baptize. Also, you'll find in your bulletin that it's that time of year again where our children in action are building their cars and getting ready for that great race. This time last year, when Jessica and I had the privilege of attending that was our first children's program that we got to attend coming to Beaver Dam. So it's very, very special event. So you'll find that in the bulletin as well. Our Wednesday night meal is coming up, and we have the sign-up sheet in the back. And if you're going to be here Wednesday night at 6 for the meal, please sign up so we can know how much food to prepare. And I would again just encourage you to read your bulletins, for the information is vital that's going on in the life of this church. Oh, one more thing. The last Sunday in January, we have the Glory Men that are going to be here. We're going to have a singing, and we're going to be taking up a love offering that evening for that group. And so I hope you'll come out and be a part of that fifth Sunday night singing. At this time, I would like to recognize Cody Allen, and he is going to come from the Ministry of the Adult Teen Challenge, and he is going to share a time of testimony.
All right. Hey, how y'all doing? My name is Cody Allen, and tell y'all a little bit about myself. I'm from Sanford, North Carolina. I'm 21, and I grew up in church. I didn't really have the relationship with God until I came here, and there's just so much good stuff in the program that, let's see. I grew up in school playing sports, basketball and soccer, and I started partying and hanging out with the wrong people, which led to me smoking weed. And then by the age of 16, I started doing meth and selling drugs. Well, one night, I was on the way back from Lillington, and I got pulled over, and I had a bunch of drugs and guns in the car. Well, I ended up going on a high-speed chase, and I got away, but 2 weeks later, the cops picked me up. And I left a little bit out. That was the third time that I'd been caught. So I was a convicted felon, and they gave me 7 years in prison. Well, I went there, and my mama heard about Teen Challenge from my cousin, which is Jeff, our director. And they started talking, and they got everything figured out. I was supposed to come here back in July, but the judge didn't want me to go. He kept postponing it. And it went on 3 months, and I just thought I was about to go do my time. Well, I went to court in August the 14th, and he denied me and told me that there was no hope for me, that I was going to do my time. Well, I was mad, but I really thought, I just felt like I deserved a second chance. And so I went back and called my mama and got on the phone, and we got to talking, and she was like, Cody, just hold on. I feel like something's going to happen. I talked to your lawyer today. She said she's going to try to get you back in court one more time. Well, I went back to my cell, and I just got down on my knees and prayed for God to just help me get out of the situation that I was in. I didn't really want to go to prison because I knew it wasn't going to be no good for me. I was going to learn more about stuff I didn't need to be doing and get back out and probably wouldn't get a second chance. I'd lose my life or just be in there the rest of my life. And when I was laying on the bed the next day and it was after lunch. They came and called my name and brought me up there. And the judge was kind of mad when he seen me because he denied my lawyer 3 times and asked what she was doing in there again with me, that he was not allowing me to go. And I think if it wouldn't have been for my mama and my 7 brothers and sisters being in there and all of them just actually being there for me, he was like, you know what, I'll tell you what, if you wear an ankle monitor the whole time you're in there and you do right and complete the program and get your GED, that he would terminate my charges, pay my restitution, terminate my probation, and cut the ankle monitor off. So the next day I was in Teen Challenge and I was like, wow, God is good. And I've been here for 5 months now, and I've learned so much about me and God and actually got that relationship with him, and it's just amazing what he can do if you just have that little bit of hope. Yeah, that's it. Thank y'all.
Our offertory hymn this morning is Something for Thee, number 607. Let's all stand and sing all 4 verses, number 607, Something for Thee.
Thank you for another beautiful Lord's Day that we've been allowed to come out and worship you. And now as we approach the throne, we can return a portion of what you have given to us. We hope that each the gift will be given to your kingdom and the furtherance of it. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
Let's thank Haley again for leading us this morning. Yeah. I'm preaching on the subject of wisdom this morning. I had gotten a pair of glasses, and I was wearing them, and I was telling my wife, these glasses make me look wise. They make me look intelligent. And she said to me, it could be a sign of old age. And I said, no, it's a sign of wisdom. You might be wondering, where are those glasses? I forgot to bring them. Which is also a sign of wisdom and not old age, that I'm forgetting things. Take your Bibles this morning and join me in the book of James, chapter 3. After a little bit of a pause, we come back to the wonderful, great, applicable book of James. I want to ask you a question this morning that is going to get to the heart of the text. In a given week, 7 days, how much time would you say that you spend in God's Word? How much time would you say that you spend in God's Word? I'm going to throw you a bone this morning. If you come to Sunday school every Sunday, there's an hour right there. And we have fabulous Sunday school teachers and fabulous Sunday schools. If you come to worship every Sunday, there's another hour there. If you come to Wednesday night, you've got another time where we dig into the Word of God. On the high end of the research that I found and the statistics that I saw, 10 minutes a day, if you are above average and you are really with it, 10 minutes a day is the statistic of people spending time in God's Word. That gives you a little bit more than an hour a week, matched with the other times. If you're faithful to do that every single week, then you have 4 hours a week that you spend in God's Word. Now maybe this morning, everybody's a lot more spiritual than those statistics that I just rattled off that I just found online. But you might be asking, what are you getting at? I mean, why is it really so important that we would make time, take time, spend time in God's Word? Well, number one, because He is worthy. Amen? Because He is worthy of our time, worthy of us seeking Him, worthy of us learning and growing in Him. But number two, in the book of Colossians, we are told that Jesus is the image of the invisible God. God the Father is invisible to us. We can't see Him, we can't walk with Him, we can't understand Him aside from meeting with Him in the Word and meeting with Him in prayer. And in that time we come together and worship Him. Somebody noted, if you want to hear God speak audibly, open your Bible and read it out loud. But you know what? Not only is God the Father invisible to us, living in this day, living in this century, Jesus is invisible to us as well. We're not living the life of the disciples. We don't see Jesus. We're not able to walk with Him physically. But the way we do walk with Him is by meeting Him in the Word. You might wonder, why is it that you, as the pastor of this church, are have the model of preaching through books of the Bible? And there's a really good answer for that question. I want to model how we are to approach Scripture, how we are to study Scripture, how we are to spend time in the Word of God in its full context, where we don't become a people that take God's Word out of context and use it for our own ends. But we understand Scripture and know Scripture, and we're growing as disciples of Christ in the Word. Here is as plainly put as I know how to put it. The Word presents Christ. Christ presents the Father. You want to know about Jesus? You want to know how to live a Christ-centered life? You want to know how to have a marriage or a parenthood or a business or anything else that's centered on Christ? Spend time in His Word. The more you spend in His Word, the better you get to know Him. The more you spend in His Word, the better you know the Father. The more time you spend in the Word, the more time you are sharpened by the Word of God and you are growing as a disciple. We are exposed to all kinds of things in this culture. We are exposed to all kinds of evils. We are exposed to all kinds of dysfunction. We are exposed to all kinds of pollution. And as my professor told me many years ago, something is discipling you. And something is discipling me. That may be the world. Maybe the media. Maybe the news outlet. It may be something else. But what we need is to be discipled by the Word of the Lord. We need to have this exposed to us as much as possible. And we need to be growing in our time in the Word of God. And if there's anything I've learned, it's that we have commentaries galore, study Bibles galore, reading plans and reading programs out there. But you know what? It really doesn't start until we intentionally make up our minds, I'm going to spend time in God's Word. You can have all the tools and resources you want to have, and so can I, but it doesn't really matter until we intentionally decide this is important. It's more important than watching TV, more important than Google, more important than Facebook, more important than anything else is to spend time in the Word of God. This is the very reason why I wanted to start a scripture challenge. I've challenged you this month with the book of Philippians, four short chapters. We reread it every week. The end of that month, four times we've read through the book of Philippians, talking about the great joy on that theme. I encourage you, not here to bash, not here to beat down, but here to encourage you, spend time in God's Word. We haven't been in James in a while, and so let me set the context for you this morning. James develops and unravels like no other epistle. It is Proverbs of the New Testament. It is wisdom literature. That's what it is. And what James does is he builds the letter around five themes. And every theme that he addresses, he gives a test. And it is a diagnostic test. It is a test not for God, but it is a test for us. It is a test that we would see where we are on that theme. And within these five themes, the question that's being answered is, are we really in the faith? Are we really in the kingdom? Do we really know Christ? Are we really growing in Christ? And today's theme is that of wisdom. That of wisdom. Not how to get more wisdom, but are we using what we've been given? And does the wisdom that we have, does it come from God's Word, from being exposed to God's Word, from spending time with God in His Word? Or does our wisdom emerge from the world? There's wisdom from above, and there's wisdom of the world. Which wisdom are we leading our lives, raising our children in? Join me in James 3 as we look at verse 13 through verse 18, this small paragraph unit here. Beginning in verse 13, "Who among you is wise and understanding? By his good conduct, he should show that his works are done in the gentleness that comes from wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and selfish ambition in your heart. Don't boast and deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from above. Notice but again. He's going to change. He's going to transition here. But is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where there is envy, selfish ambition, there is disorder and every evil practice. Notice in verse 17, the but again. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peace-loving, gentle, compliant, full of mercy and good fruits, unwavering, without pretense. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who cultivate peace. Let us pray this morning. Dear most precious and sovereign and loving and merciful Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning, before your mighty, awesome throne. And God, we come to worship today. We come to praise you today. We come to give you glory today. Whatever result that would come from us singing, from us praying, from us seeking, from us hearing, Lord, the first desire we have is to give glory to you. It is to exalt the name of Jesus above every name because he is worthy. Lord, I pray this morning that you would show up, that you would show out. I pray this morning that your spirit would lead us. I pray this morning that your word would drive us toward a decision that would be made today. Lord, you know where we are with you. And God, I just pray, Father, that you would be glorified today. For it's in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ we pray. And all God's people said,
amen.
James approaches the church. He looks at the church. The church who has been made wise unto salvation, who has heard the word of the Lord, and who has come to Christ, who have had lives that were changed. We heard a testimony earlier. Lives that are changed. I hope you believe this with me this morning. There is no life that is ever unchangeable. Amen? No life that can't come to Christ and can't be changed. And so James asks a diagnostic question, a question with a diagnosis in mind. He says, who among you, who here is wise? Who here has wisdom? Who here understands? Who here is understanding, knowing that the very people he's talking to, they would say, well, I'm wise. Well, I understand. Well, I know. Well, I have wisdom. This question does something. It really stops the congregation where they are. It really stops them and causes them to reassess. It really causes them to stop and pay close attention. Now, you may think that I don't have a boss. You may think there is no boss for me. But I want to tell you, Thursdays I love to get into the fellowship hall. And I love to have my Bible and resources scattered out across the table. And I love to get into the study of the Word. And then the door swings open and my boss comes in. She's 1 year old. She's in her stroller and most of the time she's sleeping. And I'm there studying. But I know when she has awoken. I'll talk to her grandparents. We'll have this wonderful conversation going. And she'll go, bah, 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 bah. That means stop what you're doing. That means pay attention to me.
That means I am the object and I am the focal point and I want to be part of this conversation too. Now at first, I said, okay, yeah, stay right there. Go back to the conversation. And what do you think I'm going to hear in 2 seconds later? Back, right? This is what's going on in the text. In this passage of Scripture, the question is asked, the question is posed to stop the congregation and to have them think it through. Who among you is wise? Who among you is wise? Who among you has wisdom? Who among you understands? And isn't it interesting, the way that James draws the understanding, draws the wisdom, is based off the character. Look at what happens here. So you see the question, then note what he says. Note the imperative that's coming. By his good conduct, you see that he's wise. It's based off the character of the person. He should show, that's the imperative, he should show that his works are done in the, what? Gentleness that comes from wisdom. Now I want to tell you this morning, you watch a person, you examine a person, you listen to a person, you get to know a person, and you will be able to tell what kind of wisdom they have. Is it wisdom from above? Is it wisdom that comes from a deep understanding of the Word of God? Is it a wisdom that comes because they have spent time in God's Word? They love Jesus. They love hearing about Jesus. They love to worship Jesus. They love to spend time in the Word. They are renewing their minds, as Romans 12:2 suggests, daily in the Word. And when you ask them a question, when you talk to them, you know who they know, and you know who they spend time with. I was told there was a man in our church. He is past, I think, many years now. But I was told, didn't say a lot, but when he did speak, people listened. People listened to this man. They knew his heart. They knew who he knew. And they knew that he spent time with the Lord. I didn't get to know that man. I knew a different man. And he liked to spend his mornings in the Proverbs. Every morning he would read a proverb. By the way, if you're looking for a reading plan, read a proverb every day. Read a psalm every day. Renew your mind in a proverb or a psalm every single day. Pray the proverbs. Pray the psalms. This man did that. If you had a need, if you had a problem, if you had something that was going on in your life, you could go to this man and you could ask him a question. And if you weren't in the Proverbs, if you didn't know the Proverbs, if you hadn't read the Proverbs, you might not know that what he is saying is nothing more than a proverb. But you ask him a question, and he gives you the answer to the question in a proverb. He recites a proverb to you. I want to tell you this morning, precious church, that what you are exposed to, what you expose yourself to in life, becomes the well from which your wisdom pours. If we spend our time out of the Word of God and we spend our time investing in other things or spend our time in other avenues, that's where our wisdom is going to emerge from. If we spend our time renewing our minds in Scripture, focused on Scripture, studying Scripture, memorizing Scripture, writing out Scripture, praying through Scripture, guess what? Our minds and our hearts are going to be dominated by the Word of God. I know of another guy. He was mentioning this just the other day. Has to drive some miles to work. On the way to work, plays the audio Bible. Scripture is being read as he's driving to work. Think about it. We get in our cars and we play music. We play songs and they repeat over and over and over and over again. There's nothing wrong with that. But what about if we were to drive 40 miles a day? If we were to drive 30 or 20 miles a day? We have the Bible app going and the Bible is being read over and over and over and over and over again to us. We're renewing our minds with Scripture. There's just too much pollution and too much junk out there. But let us renew our minds with the Word of God. You go back to this passage and you see the imperative should show. Should show that His works are done in the gentleness that comes from His wisdom. What we seek, what we live in, what we saturate ourselves with, what will come out. I'm reminded of a tragedy that happened in 2015. A young man walks into the African American Methodist Episcopal Church in Charleston, South Carolina, with the very intent in starting a race war. Walks in there to a Bible study where people are studying the Bible on Wednesday night. Opens fire and murders 9 people, 9 Christians, 9 Bible students because of the color of their skin. Injures another one because of the color of their skin. He actually says in testimony later after he was arrested that he almost didn't carry it out because when he went in, there was so much hate in his heart to do this act. Those people were so good to him, so affirming, so nice to him, so inviting to him, he almost didn't carry it out. But he did. You know what's more interesting? What's more interesting is his trial. I believe it's his trial. The family of the victims are able to address this man. And you might be thinking rage. You might be thinking all of these bad things that are going to be said, all this anger that's going to be poured out on this man. But every family member for those victims that spoke said, "Dylan Roof, I forgive you. I forgive you. I forgive you for murdering my mother. I forgive you for murdering my father. I forgive you for murdering my cousin. I forgive you." How? How can these people do this? How can they forgive this man? How can they really utter these words after a family member has been taken from them? They can do this because they were walking very carefully with Jesus. They can do this because they had placed themselves under the Word of God. They could do this because the Spirit of God had control of their life. Because they weren't serving two masters. Only through God's love and only through what God does in the heart could they possibly have done that. And I get it, not everybody's there. But we have to understand that. As their conduct showed that they were men and women loved Jesus and had been with Jesus. You continue to look at this passage, you notice in verse 14 through 17, that he contrasts wisdom from above and wisdom in the world. Notice, but it's mentioned 3 times and it's always a transition to go back and forth, back and forth. But if you have bitter envy, selfish ambition in your heart, don't boast and deny the truth. Don't make a mockery out of God, in other words. Verse 15, such wisdom does not come down from above, but is, watch this, earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where there is envy and selfish ambition, there is disorder and every evil practice. I have noticed in my time as a pastor that where there is dysfunction, where there is disunity, where there is arguing, Where there is blaming and gossiping and naming, where there is division, there is selfish ambition. The wisdom is not from above. The wisdom is from the earth. Well, I'm just entitled to that. It's just mine. I deserve that. I should have that. That should be mine. I just got to have that. That is what I need to have, and I deserve to have that. And why do they get that, but I don't get that? There was actually a story of a piano bench, and one family thought it should be placed in one part of the church. The piano should be on this side or that side. The other family thought something different. The church ends up splitting over the piano bench. And they have to have two separate churches now. And in different time slots, the piano bench will be here for a certain Sunday, and then it'll be over here in this other church for a certain Sunday, so we can worship because we got to have our piano bench. And you listen to that and you say, how ridiculous. Jesus is the object of our worship, not a piano bench. But we've seen it, haven't we? I mean, you can name it. Color of carpeting, drapes, all kinds of things you can think of that have divided and split churches. Because our wisdom has been over all the wrong things. And those wrong things are a diagnosis of the problem of selfish ambition, of a wisdom that's carnal and earthly and unspiritual, and it's from here and it's not from there. And I tell you, church, the more we spend time in God's Word, the more we renew our minds, the more wisdom we lead from wisdom from above and not wisdom here. I was riding down the road and going to a surgery, and I was riding with a deacon. The deacon looked at me and he said, Pastor, have you ever thought that this year, in 2023, maybe the Lord doesn't bring 40 new people or 40 new families to Beaver Dam, but maybe he takes the families that are here, and this year, maybe this year is a focal year on discipleship. Maybe this year is a year we really dig into the Word, and we really focus on being discipled, and really focus on renewing our minds with Scripture. And we need to be open to whatever God wants to do in 2023, right? And support that work. But maybe God wants to do both. Amen? Maybe God wants to bring people, but He also wants to have us not just come, not just sit, not just be here, but renew our minds with Scripture. One last thing and we're through. Look at verse 18. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who cultivate peace. How do you know if it's wisdom from above? Well, he's brought it out here. Look at what he says. Wisdom from above is pure. It is peace-loving. It is gentle, compliant, full of mercy and good fruits, unwavering, without pretense. And the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those who cultivate peace. He's not talking about peace at any cost. He's not talking about compromise the Word of God, forsake the Word of God so we can have peace. No, he's not talking about that. He's simply talking about a church that would diagnose where they are by asking the question, am I wise? And do I understand with a wisdom that's from above? And am I one that cultivates, that makes peace? Or am I one that my wisdom emerges from the world? You see, it's very, very important that we would be a church after God's own heart. We would be a church that longs to teach and preach and share the Word, but we would also be a church that is marked by these fruits of wisdom from above. Let us be a church that seeks the wisdom of God and runs from wisdom this world brings. Let us pray this morning. Dear most precious Heavenly Father, so thankful to be in your kingdom, so thankful to be your child, so thankful that you called Jessica and I to serve this great community, these great people in this great church. And Lord God, I just lift up this time of invitation to you, Lord. I just pray, God, that you would just do a work here. I pray that as we invite people to respond to what's been sang about, what's been said, what your text has said today, I pray, Lord, that we would come and we would pray and lives would be changed, rededicated, brought to you the first time, that leaders would just want, seek, Lord, to just be men and women of wisdom. Lord, that as we think about this very question, God, is our wisdom from above? I know we could never read enough in Scripture, but Lord, are we growing in our time with you? Do we barely pick up the Bible? Week in and week out, are we really reading, studying, digging in, and growing as disciples in Christ? Lord, the invitation is yours. I pray that you would lead the people how you desire. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen.
Our hymn of invitation this morning is number 307, Just As I Am. Let's all stand and sing. Number 307, Just As I Am.
Third John, John writes, I have no greater joy than to know my children are walking with the Lord. That is not just a pastoral text. That can be applied to families as well. Amen? Mom and dad, grandparents, families have no greater joy than to know their children are walking with the Lord. I want to invite the Simpson family, or Lauren, however you want to do this, to come up here. Most of you in this church have known Lauren since before she was born. And this morning, she asked Jesus to come into her life and save her and be her Savior and commit herself to Jesus as a disciple of Christ. She comes today by way of baptism. She will be one of the three next Sunday to be baptized before you. And she comes today seeking to be a member of Beaver Dam Baptist Church. All those in favor of her joining with Beaver Dam by baptism, please raise your hand. All right, that's every single person in the church. There's no reason to ask for opposition. That's unity there. We are just so excited. We are just so proud of Lauren's decision. And I want to tell you, this was not a knee-jerk reaction. This was not just heard something and came. This has been a long, long process of asking questions, processing what she's heard from being in this church and in her school, and just a lot of seeds have been planted by y'all and by others, by parents and grandparents, that has brought her to this moment. And so I'm going to ask them to remain standing. I'm going to close us in prayer, and then I'm going to let the church come and let y'all come and welcome Lauren into the family with excitement and joy. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, God, it has been an awesome day in your house, Lord. Such a joy in this pastor's heart right now. And God, we thank you for all you're doing, have done, are doing, and plan to do here, Beaver Dam Baptist Church. We thank you for Lauren, for her life, her parents, grandparents, for this church, for all the influences that have played a role in you leading her to this point. And God, we just give you the glory and the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Say welcome.
Thank you.